स्टूडेंट्स वेलकम टू डॉक्टर दीपा डाके नीट बायोलॉजी एंड इन टुडे सेशन वी कंटिन्यू विद द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ क्लास 12 एंड टुडे वी डिस्कस अबाउट द स्मॉल टॉपिक्स आफ्टर द डेवलपमेंट आफ्टर द प्रोसेस ऑफ पॉलिनेशन विच प्रोवाइडेड इन बुक्स. सम ऑफ द टॉपिक्स वी डिस्कस टुडे आर First we discuss about the outbreeding devices, then we come towards the artificial hybridization and then discuss about the fertilization and double fertilization. So let's first begins with outbreeding devices. So first here when we study about these devices, so what are these devices we study and why these devices are developed in plant. And where these devices are present, that we mainly discuss. Outbreeding devices first, as we discussed earlier, pollination is of two types, self-pollination and cross-pollination. Generally, the product of self-pollination is not good because both the gametes belongs to the same parent and because of self-pollination, if regular self-pollination is take place, so the variability will not be take place or variation will not be resulted. So to develop the variation, to develop the genetic recombination, generally plant avoid self-pollination and enter in the process of cross-pollination. So in outbreeding devices, we mainly study that what are the features or what are the characters developed by plant to avoid self-pollination, and by using these methods or by developing these methods, the bisexual flower also undergoes in the process of cross-pollination, and entirely all these processes by which the bisexual flower which show the capacity of self-pollination undergoes in the process of cross-pollination called as outbreeding devices. So when we come towards the outbreeding devices, purpose here you remember, the purpose of outbreeding devices are to avoid self-pollination in bisexual flower. First purpose you remember. Now what are the devices? Three major devices we study which were used by the plant. Among these three devices, the first we study about, the first device you remember, that is dichogamy. Dichogamy, you remember, dichogamy means the process of maturation of male and female gamete at a different time. That process is called as dichogamy. So dichogamy, you remember, dichogamy, the condition or the device, or simply we say process of maturation of male and female reproductive organs, that is androecium and gynoecium, at different time. That part is called as dichogamy. Now, if the male gametes or male reproductive organ develop first, then the condition is called protandry, and just opposite, if the female reproductive organs gynoecium is developed prior to male reproductive organ, then the process or the device is commonly called as gynandry, or it is called as protogyny. So these two terms you remember, protandry for the development of male gamete first, and if the female gametes are mature prior to male gamete, then we use the term protogyny. Now the second device comes under the outbreeding device is, that is one of the most common device used by the bisexual flowers, that is heterostyly. Heterostyly, you remember, heterostyly means for self pollination one requirement is there, that we already studied in last session, that the anther and stigma should be present at the same height. When both the structures present at same height, then only the self pollination is achieved. And if plant want to avoid the self pollination, in that condition you remember, either the length of stigma is increases or the length of filament of anther is increases. So heterostyly, that develop different length of anther filament or different length of style. So for example, here you remember, when we generally draw a self-pollinated flower, so in self-pollinated flower, generally this condition we draw that the anther and stigma present at the same level. But when the heterostyly we appear, either the length of style is excessively increases and the anther remain at their normal filamentous length, or the second condition, the stigma, style and ovary remain at a natural and normal position, but the length of filament is excessively increases, and because of that the anther and stigma or pollen and stigma not to becomes direct in contact and avoid the process of self-pollination. So this you remember called as heterostyly. With these diagram you can easily recall the process or the device that is called as heterostyly. The third device we study, that third device is one of the most important device, genetic device itself produces in plant. Secondly, in board exam, short notes are also sometime asked for this device. So the third device you remember, that third device is self incompatibility when we study about self incompatibility so here you remember, genetic method of outbreeding, first thing you remember. Secondly, when we study about self incompatibility, so here we study that this method develop special gene as in ovary. Because of that, the self-incompatibility is a process of avoiding pollination of pollen of same flower or same plant. So here you remember, by self incompatibility, autogamy and geitonogamy only avoid. It used for only to allow the process of allogamy or geitonogamy, you remember. Now what is happening? The S gene, this is the structure we draw for the incompatibility. The stigma, inside the stigma in ovary, the S gene is developed. This S gene produces certain kinds of protein. These proteins get deposited over the stigma. When the pollen grains are releases from the anther of same flower, and these pollen grains, a number of pollen grains are present, as we all are knowing, inside the lobes of anther. These pollen grains, when anther bursts and releases and reaches to the stigma. So here the both green color pollen grain that you observe, these pollen grain belong to the same flower. They are having the similar genetic makeup to that of the egg. In that condition, this S gene not allow the germination of such pollen. When the pollen grains comes from the here the plant of same species, but it belongs to the flower of same species, belongs to another plant. When the pollen grains are reaches to the stigma, this pollen grains of the same plant, of the same species, but they are genetically variated or genetically different pollen grain. In that condition, you remember, the S gene allow the pollen germination, and then only the fertilization is proceed. So this is the method. Simple terms, you remember, the process by which plant or the stigma not allow the autogamy as well as gametogamy. That process is called as self incompatibility. Why it is present? Because in majority of angiosperm species, the ovary develop one S gene, and this gene product protein is mainly responsible for the process of self incompatibility. So this, all these three techniques you very well remember for the outbreeding devices. And now we come towards the second topic of today's session, that we discuss about the artificial hybridization. So here we discuss about the second method or special topic, that is artificial hybridization. All these small topics are there, but these topics are mainly important for short note type of question and major questions for the chapter reproduction in NEET exams. Generally ask from these topic, and most of the time students skip these topics without reading NCERT. So you go through the NCERT again and again for these topic. Now what is artificial hybridization? Hybridization we term mainly used for the process of cross pollination. So when cross pollination is achieved by artificial mean, means by human interference or by using some scientific techniques, then called artificial hybridization. This part you remember first very well. Secondly, what are the techniques of artificial hybridization? This again the important question for board. What are the two important techniques of artificial hybridization? So two important techniques of hybridization, artificial hybridization, are the first is emasculation and the second is bagging. Now here we discuss what is emasculation and what is bagging. When we study about emasculation, so in emasculation you remember the removal of anther, simply we say in one term, the process of removal of anther by sterilized needle or forceps. is called emasculation. Secondly, for emasculation, in another terms, question also asks the how the bisexual flower can be converted into unisexual. So to convert the bisexual flower into unisexual, one can go through the emasculation. So the name is only asked, name the technique by which the bisexual flower become a unisexual. So that you remember, emasculation is the technique in which we remove the anther. So because of that, the bisexual flower when undergoes in emasculation, so that emasculated flower behave as a female flower. So this part you remember. Now emasculation, you remember, upon emasculation, flower become a female flower and only used to produce eggs. So this part you remember. Now once the emasculation is completed, then the process of bagging begins. So in the phenomenon of bagging, you remember, when we discuss about bagging, bagging generally student understood that the wrapping of emasculated flower, but by what we wrap that emasculated flower. So bagging means simply, you remember, wrapping or covering of emasculated flower by bags of important thing, butter paper. This question also asked one year that the bags are made up of clear air, polythene, blotting paper. Blotting paper also you can say in NCERT, butter paper is provided, so you only go through the butter paper. So the bags of butter paper are used for covering of the emasculated flower, and that process is called as bagging. What is the purpose of bagging? So here you remember, the main purpose of bagging is to avoid exposure of unwanted pollen grains. Unwanted or undesired pollen grain. So this part you remember very well. To avoid exposure of unwanted pollen grain, we generally grow for a process of bagging. Once the stigma become mature, when will we remove the bags? Once the stigma attain a receptivity or stigma become mature, then after we remove the bags, select the pollen grain from a particular species of the same plant, and then those pollen grains are dusted over the stigma, and after that again the pollinated stigma again undergoes in the process of bagging, or sometime the same bags or another bags of the butter paper again used for the covering of the pollinated stigma to assure the pollination and pollen germination phenomena. So these two techniques you remember for the emasculation and bagging phenomena. Once the pollen grain reaches to the stigma, after that you remember, one another definition, one another side heading is provided in NCERT, that is the pollen pistil interaction. What is pollen pistil interaction? Pollen pistil interaction, you simply remember, when the pollen grain reaches to the stigma, then you remember, this is the emasculated flower or simple flower, you remember, and when the pollen grains are reaches to stigma, red pollen grains of the same species, and this is the pollen grain of another species, this is the pollen grain of B species, these are the pollen grain of A species or same species, here you remember. So what is happening, the pollination is always occurs in between the same species or in the same flower of the same plant. Now here we study, when the pollen grain, different pollen grains from a different plant, different species come in contact over the stigma, due to pollen pistil interaction. This stigma has a potentiality to recognize the pollen grain of its own species, and though the pollen of the same plant or comes from the different plant. Once this stigma recognizes the pollen grain of same species, then only it allows the process of germination. This pollen grain of another species are totally rejected because the proteins and the certain chemical which are present on the surface of stigma as well as surface of pollen will not be matched. When the matching is take place in between the pollen and stigma, then only the pollination is proceed. Pollination proceed in pollen germination, and after the fertilization and phenomena of double fertilization is take place. So this much you remember for the general term, that you remember for the pollen pistil interaction. Once the pollen pistil interaction successfully take place, after that we study about the next process, that is called as fertilization. So as you all are knowing about the process of fertilization, that the fusion of male and female gamete is called as fertilization. Male gametes are non-motile, therefore they carry towards the ovary and ovule with the help of pollination. Now first year during fertilization, first you remember, upon pollen pistil interaction, pollen germination is take place, and this germinated pollen grain develop a pollen tube. So now pollen tube enter in ovule. When the pollen tube enter in ovule, so this pollen tube, you remember, enter by any one method. One method, first method is called as porogamy. Second method of pollen tube enter in ovule is chalazogamy, and the third method is called as mesogamy. This part you remember. That means either or condition, porogamy, chalazogamy or the mesogamy is appear. Now what is these? Porogamy means the pollen tube enter in ovule via micropipe. So all you remember, or all of you recall the structure of ovule. So whenever inside the ovule pollen tube enter through micropipe, it is called porogamy. Here it enter by chalaza, then it is called as chalazogamy, and here the pollen tube enter through or enter by the region of integument, outer and inner integument. So this part you remember. Just the simplest diagram again one time I draw here. Ovule, we already study. The students who are new for the session, they go through the videos for this session where we discuss about the structure of ovule. At micropyle we already study, egg apparatus is there, centrally secondary nucleus, and at chalazal end three antipodal cells are there. If the pollen tube directly enter through the micropyle, then it is called as porogamy. If the pollen tube enter through the chalazal region of the ovule, then the process is called as chalazogamy, or sometime pollen tube is directly enter through the integument. So here you remember, any one method is used by pollen tube for the entry inside the ovule. Now after that, once the pollen tube enter inside the ovule, it always reaches towards the kis region pe aayega, it reaches towards the micropyle end, because fertilization is always take place at the micropyle end of the ovule. Why? Because in embryo sac, egg is always present, egg kahan par present hai, egg is always present at a micropyle. So now you remember, once the pollen tube enter in ovule, now the pollen tube enter in egg apparatus. So here you remember when pollen tube enter in egg apparatus. So here I draw the simplest structure of female gametophyte. This is the micropyle end and this is the chalazal end. This is egg cell. These are the synergids. Inside the synergids we draw the filiform apparatus, and this is the secondary nucleus showing the polar nuclei. Now what is happening when the pollen tube enter in egg apparatus for the purpose of fertilization? So this pollen tube carry the two male gamete. One thing you remember, pollen tube never directly enter in egg cell. First this pollen tube enter inside any one of the synergid cell, and during this process the filiform apparatus helpful to the pollen tube, and this filiform apparatus produces some protein. These proteins provide the path to pollen tube, and then the pollen tube enters inside the egg cell. Here pollen tube releases the male gamete. The first male gamete comes in contact with the egg cell, and upon fertilization you remember the diploid structure is formed. This diploid structure is called as zygote. So here you remember fertilization, as a rule fertilization in most of the higher plants and animals take place inside the female body. The male gamete in the form of non-motile male gamete, the first male gamete fused with egg nucleus at a micropyle end and will result in the formation of zygote. Now what about the second male gamete? This second male gamete, you remember the second male gamete, now we come towards the double fertilization, because fertilization and double fertilization we study simultaneously, and the rest part of double fertilization we discuss in quite detail form when we discuss about the endosperm and its type in next class, because the double fertilization result in the development of primary endosperm cell, and this endosperm cell will lead to the formation of endosperm. So here you remember the second male gamete is comes towards the center, and inside the central cell this second male gamete fused with the secondary nucleus. Because of this fusion, you remember the 3N structure is formed, or triploid structure is formed. Why triploid? Because the secondary nucleus is diploid and the male nucleus, second male nucleus or male gamete is haploid. So this triploid structure is formed. This triploid structure, you remember, is called as primary endosperm cell or primary endosperm nucleus. So fertilization when completed in angiosperm, then the identical property of angiosperm is double fertilization. Double fertilization is the process of fusion of second male gamete with secondary nucleus or central cell. Double fertilization is also called as triple fusion, because the three nuclei are involved in this fusion. One nucleus of male gamete and the two nuclei of polar nuclei. Two nuclei as a polar nuclei. That's why double fertilization is called as triple fusion. This question also repeatedly asked in your board exam, that why in angiosperm double fertilization is called as triple fusion. So that you mentioned, because the three nuclei are involved. What are these three nuclei? That also you mentioned. That's why it is called triple fusion. What is the result of triple fusion? The triple fusion always resulted in triploid cell or triploid nucleus, that is called as primary endosperm cell. From after this, we will continue in next sessions, because the zygote now will undergoes in embryogeny, and it will lead to the development of embryo. But before that, This primary endosperm cell will undergoes in division and will develop a highly nutritive tissue endosperm. That endosperm provide a nutrient to the developing embryo. So this is for today's session. In next session, what we discuss, that I already told you. So the students, one time you go through the NCERT for this session, because particularly for this, entirely this is a theoretical part, so reading quite boring for student also. So you one time again I request that carefully you go through the NCERT for the topic whatever we studied today, underline all the important parts which we discuss here. And the students who are new for the session, they kindly subscribe my channel, like my videos, and by the next session, stay motivated, work hard, and stay blessed.